So we'll start with the early influence and how you came to grow interested in literature and in Urdu per se.
Mm-hmm.
And how did that happen? Was it like something you inherited or something that you found for yourself? Or?
Well, I didn't quite inherit it. And in fact, it's a question that I've been asked a number of times, and I always tried to get a good answer to it, but I couldn't. It's because, as you know, in our family, there was a lot of strong tradition of religion and of a certain kind of learning on my father's side. On my mother's side, there was a lot of Persian and Arabic, but in the past days, by about the end of the 19th century, all that was gone. So although people talked about poetry, people talked about books, my father particularly, nothing like an environment or nothing like a background from which I could start. I can only say, even if it sounds rather unbelievable, then when I was 7 years old, I decided that I have to be a poet. Why? I don't know. Perhaps it was kind of natural for me to think in those terms. And I began composing a little bit in my own stuttering, tottering way, a little bit of poetry. And my first line of poetry was expressing the depth of my heart's pains.
Do you remember the line?
Maloom kya kisi ko mera haal zahar hai.
Wow.
Imagine a 7-year-old boy talking about the Hal-e-Zahar, Muslim broken-heartedness and the depth. Anyway, it didn't go on, but I began writing prose, stories, essays, quite after that. At the age of about 9 or so, I began to issue a house magazine, writing it myself, cutting down pieces of paper from wherever I could find them. Every which way, none of them were really straight. I could never cut a straight in my whole life. So I used to write my poems, my essays, and my older sister, Zuhara, who is now in Pakistan, she also was fond of writing. So she wrote some stories. It went on for many years, in fact. It went on for about, 5 or 6 or 7 years. And gradually, I began veering more towards fiction. Partly because I was, as you know, there was a time when the great giants were striding the stage of Urdu literature. Giants of fiction. Krishnandar, Bedi Sahab, Mantu Sahab, Isma Choktai, and many more. So it was quite natural for me to sort of walk in their footsteps. So I began writing stories. And by the time I was 15 years old, I also wrote a novel. Imagine. I mean, I'm quite ashamed of it now when I think of it. And a friend of mine, whom we also know, Abrar Azmi, he keeps threatening to print it now again.
He has a copy.
He has a copy. He is the only one in the world who has a copy. I don't have one. So it was published in four short installments in a magazine called Meerut. Sorry, Mayar from Meerut. It was actually, you know, that kind of story that young people write about women and purity and chastity and God and the world of the village being so simple. And the young boy from the city being so sophisticated, all that I wrote, you know. So, I mean, I wrote it when I was 15 years old, and my teacher, God bless them, and my teachers, the one who taught me English and the one who taught me a little bit of Urdu, not in class, because in class I wasn't reading any Urdu. So they both admired it and said, ha, it's quite good. This was in Urdu, yes. Then my first real story that I should think, a real story, was when I was in the, about the same time, about the same age, 1950-51. And a blessed memory, one of the lecturers and teachers of Urdu in my college in Gorakhpur, where you also grew up and read, said, hey, this really, it seemed to read to me like the story of some mature, major writer. And I was so stupid and so overwhelmed, I didn't even thank him. I only said, sir, ye mera hi likha hua tha. As if he's accusing me of plagiarism. I was so stupid and I was so young and so gadha in those days. Really, you have this small courtesy of life to thank my teacher. Later on, when I went to university, I translated their story into English and gave it for the university magazine. And they accepted it. Because I don't have a copy of the Urdu or the English, but that's how I began, you know.
So I'm intrigued. I mean, how does this aspiration to be a poet? Where did the seed come in? Did you see poets? Were poets discussed in the house?
Yes, that is true. Poetry was discussed in my house. Poets also were discussed, particularly Iqbal, for example. My father was a great lover of Iqbal's poetry.
But so poets were seen in the culture.
Yes, they were a part of my culture. They were a part of my scene all the time. Like living presences, which I'm always fond of saying that for us, of the Indo-Muslim culture, a poet who lived 1,000 years ago, like Saadi, he's our next door neighbor. We can talk about him and we can quote his verses without any sense of anachronism. So that was there in my house, in my father's house, mother's house, my larger family, which you also remember. But I didn't take it as an incentive to write. But you see, our family was mostly civil servants and teachers. So the incentive for me was to become a good teacher or a civil servant if possible. And sort of support myself and support my family and so forth, bring honor to my parents by ending up as a senior officer or something like that. So there was nothing like any incentive or any kind of fillip or any kind of pressure on me to become a writer. I just knew that it must do so. And I also knew that it really won't be sort of happening in a real life sense. Maybe I'll end up as a minor civil servant or a teacher or something, but nothing more. I remember when I was at the same time that I was talking about the novel that I wrote, at your house, I don't remember that person who came visiting, somebody, some distant relation. So he was fond of palmistry. He looked at my hand. Hey, you are going to be a good writer, a great writer. So what I remember is not the prophecy, but the word he used was muaddib.
Muaddib.
Which is not really mean, doesn't mean a writer actually. I should have said adib. So what struck me, stuck in my memory is the word muaddib, which of course means a person who teaches. Anyway, so I didn't believe him. So there was, I must say that, of course, coming as I do, as you also do, from a very long line of religious people, scholars, who books were important for them, who taught and read Urdu and English and Persian, and valued Persian literature, Urdu literature, particularly Persian literature. But it was nothing at all like a fuel to my ambition. It was just there. So I really can't answer the question how or why or when I become a writer. Except that, as I told you, by the age of 7, 8, I was composing all sorts of music, structuring childish things. How I switched over from fiction to poetry is another story. Fiction to criticism. See, I, as a small boy also, I remember very well that critics and people who describe literature in our culture, they used to use certain words of which I didn't really could understand the meaning of. For example, I remember one of your grandfathers and my older uncle, who was also a teacher of Persian and Arabic. So I wrote a short essay in Urdu about the characteristics of Urdu writers and poets. So what I had heard from outside was that Momin was a Muamila Band. So what this Muamila Bandi could be, I had no idea at all. I had the faintest notion. But I wrote Ghalib, Nazu Khayali, Momin, Muamila Bandi. And when he saw it, this boy is right. He Momin is a Muamila Band poet. I didn't have the courage to ask him, what the hell does it mean? So it took me a long, long time to realize that contrary to what I have been taught in school and college, that Urdu literature or Urdu literary culture does not have any intellectual background or any intellectual apparatus to understand poetry. It has that, but we don't really know about them. We have lost them. So that's how I thought, I'll write about these people. I'll write about Baal, I'll write about Ghalib. I'll write about how I understand them to be, how to distinguish Mir from Ghalib. The standard way in those days was, Ghalib, Ghalib hai, Mir, Mir hai. But I later on when I read the great Persian and Arabic and Urdu Islamist and scholar Shibli Namani, so in his fourth volume or the third volume of Sherul Ajam, the history of Persian poetry, he wrote a 30-page dissertation on Firdausi and Nizami, and then he said, Baharhal, Firdausi, Firdausi hai, Nizami, Nizami. So what do I get out of it, yeah? So I said, nahin, I should find something to say about the people. Really, that you can identify them as Momin and Ghalib and Iqbal.
And this ambition you had while you were at university.
Yes, while I was at university. By that time, I had grown and also grown out of another ambition to be a poet in English.
You tried your hand at it.
I tried my hand at it, and one of my colleagues who was really actually a rival of mine from Aligarh University, he told me that, hey, my professor was admiring the poems in English. So I gave it up quickly. I said, nahin. So I wrote some poetry and I tried my hand at criticism and failed miserably to find an audience, as you know very well. It took me many, many years of struggle to let people know that I was saying something. That I was saying something which was different, but also meaningful.
You had great teachers at the university.
I had, yes, certainly Professor S.C. Dev, who taught also Askari and a whole long line of great scholars. But even they, you know, Dev was a crotchety old man. By chance, you see, when we were reading the Jacobian and Shakespearean dramatist, so I had in my hand suddenly, by chance, a book by the famous woman scholar Una Ellis Fermor. You are not fit to read these things. You should read only those things that we teach you. These things are not for you.
He didn't
encourage independent thinking. He was a great scholar. I say great in all capitals. He knew, of course, English, he was an absolute master. French, he was absolutely in command. Italian, he knew. Sanskrit, he knew. Bengali, of course, was his own tongue. Urdu, he knew. Persian, he knew. But he wanted people and students to draw just their line, the narrow line that was before us. So these people didn't really get, or like Professor Dastur, who taught us Chaucer and Middle English, a man of great learning and a very, very lively person. But they were not really in any way my role models, because they didn't encourage you to adopt a role. They encouraged you to just be there, that's all, and pass your exam and go to hell. So I learned from these people, and I certainly, my memory of Professor S.C. Dev is mostly unkind memories, but still I admire and love and respect him for what he was. But you see, I again want to emphasize that nobody seems to believe that I did all this on my own.
On your own.
There was no one to tell me that, look, you must become a writer. That, look, you have a sense of poetry and literature, you must express it in your words. And of course, as you know, writing poetry was frowned upon in our family, because people thought that is a waste of time. And of course, I was never really a full-time poet. So it's just one of those things, really. I really can't explain it.